Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. The news articles along with the page numbers are displayed here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles is given in the description box as well as in the comment section. Now let us start our today's news analysis. This news article is about the number of OCI registrations done in India between 2000 and 2019. So in this context, we will be discussing in detail about the overseas citizenship of India, that is OCI card holder. Then during the analysis, we'll compare the OCI card holders with the persons of Indian origin and non-residential Indians. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now, if you look at the provisions of Indian Constitution, it does not allow dual citizenship, that is holding Indian citizenship and foreign citizenship simultaneously. However, there were persistent demands for dual citizenship, particularly from the Indian diaspora in North America and other developed countries. So, in this regard, the High-Level Committee on Indian Diaspora was constituted by the Government of India in 2000 to recommend measures for a constructive relationship with the Indian diaspora. So, based on the committee's recommendations, the Government of India decided to register persons of Indian origin, that is PIOs of certain specified countries, as overseas citizenship of India. As a result, the overseas citizenship of India, that is OCI scheme, was introduced by amending the Citizenship Act of 1955 through the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2005. As per this scheme, it provides for registration of persons of Indian origin as overseas citizen of India. See, when you say persons of Indian origin, that is PIO, is a person who was an Indian national or any of ancestors was an Indian national and who is presently holding other country's citizenship. That is, he or she is holding foreign passport. So, we can say that as per the Indian Constitution, that is, there is no provision for dual citizenship. As a result, the registered overseas citizens of India shall not be entitled to the rights that are conferred on a citizen of India under the Article 16 of the Indian Constitution. This Article 16 of Indian Constitution deals with equality of opportunity in the matters of public employment. Even the OCI card holders does not confer political rights for its card holders. So, the persons registered as OCI card holders have not been given any voting rights. That is, to participate in the elections of Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha or Legislative Assembly or Legislative Council. Even OCI card holder cannot hold constitutional posts such as President, Vice President or Judges of Supreme Court or High Courts. So, we can say that these are certain rights or privileges enjoyed by the citizens of India but not by overseas citizens of India. Now, let us discuss the eligibility to register as an OCI card holder. That is, the foreign nationals of the following categories are eligible to register as OCI card holder. Now, the person who was a citizen of India or who was eligible to become a citizen of India at the time of the commencement of Indian Constitution or at any time after the commencement of the Indian Constitution is eligible to be registered as OCI card holder. Then, a person who belonged to a territory that became part of India after 15th August 1947 or after India's independence is also eligible to be registered as OCI card holder. For example, the territories that became part of India after India's independence are Sikkim, Puducherry, Dadra Nagar Haveli, Goa and Daman and Diu. Then, minor children of these citizens, even the spouse of a citizen of India who is of a foreign origin or the spouse of foreign origin of an overseas citizen of India card holder is also eligible to register as OCI card holder. Kindly notice that the people of Pakistani and Bangladeshi origin are not eligible to get OCI card. Now, let us discuss some of the benefits enjoyed by the OCI card holder. That is, they can visit India without visa for lifelong. That means they will have multiple entry lifelong visa for visiting India for any purpose. However, OCI card holders will require a special permission to undertake research work in the country. Then the other benefits that are enjoyed by OCI cardholders are exemption from registration with Foreigners Regional Registration Officer, that is FRRO, for any length of stay in the country. But the PIOs needs to register with local police authorities if their period of stay is more than 180 days. Then the other benefits of OSA cardholders includes parity with non-resident Indians in respect of all facilities that are available to them in economic, financial and educational fields except in the matters related to the acquisition of agricultural or plantation properties. When you say non-resident Indian, that is, NRI is an Indian citizen who is ordinarily residing outside India but holds an Indian passport. Then the other benefits enjoyed by OSA cardholders are they will be treated on par with non-resident Indians in the matter of inter-country adoption of Indian children. So these are certain benefits that are given for OSA cardholders. Now, we'll see the cancellation power of central government. It is as per the Section 7D of Citizenship Act of 1955. Therefore, as per Section 7D of Citizenship Act of 1955, the central government can cancel if it is satisfied that the registration as an overseas citizen of India was obtained by means of fraud or false representation or the concealment of any material fact. So, these are certain grounds as per 7D of Citizenship Act of 1955 so that the central government can revoke OCI card. Now, if you look at recent episode, that is OSA card of writer Atish Tasir was cancelled by the central government based on this provision. This provision, that is Section 70 of Citizenship Act of 1955, we have discussed in detail in our 12th November 2019 analysis video. You can refer this video for your better understanding. Now, if you look at the news article, which says that about 34 lakh overseas citizen of India, that is OCI registrations, had been done from 1st January 2000 to 26th November 2019. This information is given by Ministry of Home Affairs as a reply to an RTA application. But the ministry has declined to give information relating to the number of persons whose OCI cards had been cancelled. The ministry said that this information cannot be given because the information falls outside the mandate and scope of the RTA Act of 2005. Now, as per the news article, the OSA cards could be cancelled under Section 7D of Citizenship Act of 1955. And also, the other grounds for cancelling OSA cards are if the overseas citizen of India has shown disaffection towards the Constitution of India, or unlawfully traded or communicated with an enemy, or has been sentenced to imprisonment for a term of not less than 2 years within 5 years after registration as an OCI citizen. Even the central government can cancel OCI card if it is necessary to do so in the interest of the sovereignty and the integrity of the nation. So these are certain grounds for the cancellation of OCI card. Now, we will discuss some of the recent relaxation that are given to get OCI card. That is, the children and the spouse of foreign military personnel or police personnel, either working or retired, can also eligible to get OCI card. And the foreign nationals who are working in private security agencies or home offices, that is home office or prisons or national probation service, and companies or organizations which are associated with the home office or military institutions may be considered for registration as OCI card holder. Then adopted children or children born in live-in relationship and the children born out of IVF or surrogacy may be considered for registration as OCI card holder. So, in the context of this news article, we have discussed in detail about the overseas citizenship of India, that is OCI card holder. Then, we have compared the OCI card holders with the persons of Indian origin and the non-residential Indians. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The display practice question will be discussed at the end of this session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This news article is based on a research study conducted by international team of researchers on the different rates of carbon capture in different types of forests and plantations and also the different levels of carbon storage. So, in the context of this news article, we'll be discussing about carbon storage and carbon capture and the outcomes of the research study mentioned in the news article. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now, what is meant by carbon capture and storage? know that one of the gases which are naturally present in the Earth's atmosphere as a part of the carbon cycle is carbon dioxide. When you say carbon cycle, it refers to the natural circulation of carbon dioxide or carbon among the different spheres of Earth, and these spheres are atmosphere, hydrosphere, lithosphere and biosphere. That is, the natural circulation of carbon among atmosphere, hydrosphere, lithosphere and biosphere. Know that carbon dioxide is the primary greenhouse gas that is emitted through different human activities. And due to increased combustion of fossil fuels and due to lot of industrial processes, there are increased CO2 emissions in the Earth's atmosphere. Therefore, increased CO2 emissions are one of the main reasons for global warming. So, to reduce the impact of global warming, we have to reduce CO2 emissions. Therefore, to reduce the CO2 emissions, we have to reduce the fossil fuel consumption and to increase energy efficiency and energy conservation methods. Now, we'll see other ways to reduce CO2 emissions. Here, one of the other ways to reduce CO2 emissions is carbon capture and storage, which is known as carbon sequestration. So, in simple words, carbon sequestration is the process of removing carbon from the atmosphere and depositing in a designated place that is known as carbon reservoir. This reservoir is also called as carbon pool. Now, we'll see about carbon sink, which is an area that absorbs carbon. It involves any process or mechanism which removes greenhouse gases like CO2 from the atmosphere. Here, a carbon pool can be a carbon sink if more carbon is flowing into it than flowing out of it during a given interval of time. Know that carbon sink is of two types, that is natural sink and also an artificial sink. Here, forest, oceans, soil types are best examples for natural carbon sinks. Whereas artificial sinks include depleted oil reserves, then dysfunctional mines. So, we can see that forest is a natural carbon sink because forests play an important role in mitigation and adaptation to climate change impact. Therefore, forests are considered as a sink, reservoir and also source of carbon. So, healthy and growing forests sequester more carbon than any other terrestrial ecosystem. Therefore, carbon sequestration by forest has attracted much interest globally because it is relatively cheaper means of mitigation to climate change. Now, if you see India, it has a diversity of natural biomes from deserts to alpine meadows, tropical rainforests to temperate pine forests, mangroves to coral reefs, and marshlands to high altitude lakes. So, the diversity of forests in India makes it resilient to climate change and also an efficient carbon sink. So, in the context of this news article, try to remember these terms which are important from exam point of view. Now, if you look at the news article which mentions that the outcomes of research study conducted by an international researchers. The international team of researchers have conducted a study to understand the carbon storage and the rate of carbon capture in natural evergreen forest, then deciduous forest, and in teak plantations and also in eucalyptus plantations. The research is based on by conducting surveys to estimate carbon storage of trees inside Annamalai Tiger Reserves. The researchers also used satellite data from multiple locations like Parambikulam Tiger Reserve, Rajiv Gandhi Tiger Reserve, Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary and Bhadra Tiger Reserve along with Annamalai Tiger Reserve. The satellite data was used to assess the rate of carbon capture and how they varied across years from 2000 to 2018. Now, have a look at this table to know the location of these protected areas in their respective states. Now, if you look at the research outcomes for carbon storage, the researchers found that carbon storage was highest in evergreen forest, because evergreen forest is rich in various plant species. The research also found that teak plantations stored nearly as much carbon as deciduous forest, and then eucalyptus plantations had comparatively lower carbon storage levels. Now, coming to the research outcomes for the rate of carbon capture, the researchers found that the rate of carbon capture was more stable across natural forests when compared to plantations. They also found that carbon capture by natural forest was more resilient to drought conditions. So these are the main outcomes of this research study. Now, how this research study is going to be important for the policy makers? Whenever you find such research studies related to environment, try to analyze how it will be useful for you as a policy maker to implement them practically. One such example is that this research study can help to transform the reforestation policies of the government. That is, as per the government data that are currently available, over half of the compensatory afforestation plantations uses not more than 5 species. So growing 5 or less than 5 plant species in compensatory afforestation plantations and practicing monoculture are inadequate and they will not increase the biodiversity. When you say monoculture, it means to cultivate only a single species of trees in a given area. That is, for example, teak plantation or eucalyptus plantation. So, this research study has concluded that the rate of carbon capture in such plantations will not be stable. Therefore, it is better to protect and regenerate natural forests which have diverse mix of native tree species. Also, it is more reliable in the long term as a strategy for mitigating climate change. This is because species-rich forests are beneficial for biodiversity as they also provide habitat to many other components like insects, birds, etc. Such multi-species forests would likely show greater resilience in case of forest fires. This is because different trees have varying degree of fire resistance depending on the thickness of the bark. And also the ability to regenerate the seeds differs across the species. So a multi-species forest is beneficial in all aspects. So this research study can help in transforming the reforestation policies of the government. So to summarize this news article analysis, we have discussed the concept of carbon capture and storage, that is carbon sequestration. Then we discuss different terms like carbon pool and different types of carbon sinks, that is natural carbon sink and artificial carbon sinks. And also we discussed the important outcomes of the research study that is mentioned in this news article. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the next news article analysis. This news article is based on a New York Times article which expressed the concerns about the health crisis that is emerging due to drug-resistant germs. These emerging multi-drug-resistant germs affected almost 3 million people across the world every year. On the other hand, the companies that are developing new versions of the drugs are losing large amount of money in their research and development activities. As per the news article, because of the growing losses, the companies are going out of the business as they gain no long-term profit. The United Nations stated that if you don't find drugs to fight and kill these MDR germs, the global health toll could increase to 10 million people by 2050. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. So in this context, today we are going to see what is multi-drug resistant germs, then how these MDR germs develop resistance to drugs, then why there is very limited R&D against MDR germs globally, then what are the issues that are troubling the antibiotic startups and drug firms, and finally we'll see about India's role in MDR drugs research and development. Now we'll see about multi-drug resistant germs. See, microorganisms such as bacteria, fungi, viruses and parasites are becoming resistant and ineffective to the antimicrobial drugs such as antibiotics, antifungal, antiviral and antimalarial drugs. So it is also known as antimicrobial resistance. Kindly know that antibiotics mean drugs which are used to treat bacterial infections, whereas antifungal means drugs which are used to treat fungal infections. Then antiviral means drugs which are used to treat viral infections. Therefore, antimicrobial includes antibiotics, antifungal, antiviral and antimalarial. Now, the multi-drug resistance occurs naturally over a period of time, that is usually through genetic changes. And also, in many places, antibiotics are overused and misused in people as well as in animals. Therefore, the overuse and the misuse of antimicrobial is accelerating the multi-drug resistance. For example, antibiotics like penicillin, erythromycin and ofloxacin were introduced about 70 years ago. These are conventional drugs and effectively kills millions of pathogens. However, a tiny population of germs had survived, and this was possible due to slight changes in the genes. The genetic changes in germs stop the antibiotic drugs from entering their cells or pump out the entered drug molecules. As a result, these escaped germs started growing and multiplying into millions over a period of time. As a result, they become resistant to all the common antimicrobial drugs. And these are known as multi-drug resistant germs, that is MDR germs. Now, what is needed in this scenario? That is, the scientist and the drug firms have to do the basic and fundamental research into the biology of MDR germs. Then they need to develop effective drugs to fight against the MDR germs. This usually takes a decade or more time to develop such drugs. And the amount of investment for R&D in each one of the drugs has been billions of dollars, and the company expects to gain billions of dollars every year. Now, the problem is that the companies have invested billions to develop these drugs, but they have not found a way to make money by selling these drugs. This is because most of the antibiotics are just prescribed for days or for weeks. And it is here the problem lies. Whereas in case of chronic diseases like diabetes, arthritis, blood disorder and cancer, drugs are prescribed for long terms so that the firms could make profit. But in case of fight against MDR germs, the antibiotics are prescribed for days and at best for weeks. So no long-term profit is made in selling these drugs. Therefore, this discourages the drug firms in investing in drugs against MDR germs. The article also mentions some examples like how the major drug firms and the startups like Tetraphase and Aradim went bankrupt as they could not make any sustained profit in R&D activities against MDR diseases. Now, we will see other factors that are contributing to the losses of drug developing countries. These factors include low-level political commitment in framing relevant policies, then not having adequate infrastructures like incubation centers, then research parks, and to some extent, advanced technology that is needed for R&D activities. So, in such crisis situation, what could be the role for Indian firms in R&D activities, especially in MDR drug research? In this case, the Indian firms, that is both private and public companies, may interact with the drug firms across the globe, then they can get the hard-earned technology of making drugs active against MDR germs. Then finally make these drugs available for use by the needy people, not only in India, but across the world. Then the Indian government is also trying to come up with initiatives to fight against MDR diseases. That is, to reduce the burden of MDR-TB, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has developed the National Strategic Plan for Tuberculosis for the period of 2017 to 2025. The goal of this National Strategic Plan is to end TB by 2025. And this strategic plan targets both the drug-resistant TB and also HIV-resistant TB. Kindly know that at a global level, the World Health Organization passed a resolution in the month of May 2014 to end the global TB epidemic. And this resolution is known as WHO End TB Strategy. It targets to reduce TB deaths by about 95% and to reduce the new cases by 90% between 2015 to 2035. So, in the context of this news article, we have discussed MDR tuberculosis as an example. But many other pathogens are developing resistance towards the antimicrobial drugs. Therefore, in the context of growing antimicrobial drug resistance, there shall be suitable research into the biology of MTR germs and to develop effective drugs and to fight against these MDR germs. The news article is also calling for the private non-profit foundations along with the Indian government and its funding agencies should come forward and invest in R&D, especially against the emerging MDR diseases. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The display practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This news article is about the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act of 2019. In this context, we will be discussing in brief about some of the important provisions of the Act and the concerns raised by the transgender communities and the social activists. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now, let us discuss in brief about the Act, that is the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill of 2019, which was passed in Lok Sabha in the month of August 2019. And then the Rajya Sabha cleared the bill in the month of November 2019, and in the month of December 2019, it received the assent of the President of India. The Act extends to the whole of India and it aims to protect the rights of the transgender community and to ensure their welfare. Now, if you look at the Supreme Court judgment, that is in 2014, in the Nalsa versus Union of India case, the Supreme Court had stated that the fundamental rights which are granted under the Constitution of India will be equally applicable to transgender community. And the Supreme Court gave them the right to self-identification of their gender. That is self-identification of transgender as male or female or third gender. The Supreme Court also mandated that the central and state governments have to ensure legal recognition of all transgender persons and to ensure and proactive measures instituted for their welfare. Therefore, this act can be viewed as a right step in this direction. Now, we'll see the important provisions of the act, that is, the act defines a transgender person as a person whose gender does not match with the gender assigned to that person at the time of birth. Then the Act prohibits discrimination against transgender persons on various grounds such as the denial or discontinuation or unfair treatment in educational establishments or the denial or termination from or unfair treatment in relation to employment opportunities or the denial or discontinuation or unfair treatment in healthcare services, then also denial or unfair treatment with regard to the right of movement or right to reside or right to purchase, etc. The Act also provides for a certificate of identity. The Act states that a transgender person may make an application to the district magistrate for a certificate of identity indicating the gender as transgender. Whereas in case of a minor child, the applications could be made by the guardian of the child. Then, the Act says that the government is under obligation to make adequate steps and welfare schemes to ensure full and effective participation of transgender persons and their inclusion in society. Know that every educational institution funded or recognized by the government shall provide inclusive education and inclusive opportunities in terms of sports or recreation or leisure activities to transgender persons without discrimination on an equal basis with others. Then the another important provision is regarding the establishment of a National Council for Transgender Persons. The Union Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment will be the ex officio chairperson of this council. The council will have representatives from the National Human Rights Commission and National Commission for Women, and also the council will have representatives from state governments and union territories. The council will also have representatives from non-governmental organizations or associations working for the welfare of transgender communities. So, these are important provisions of Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act of 2019. Now, let us see the important penal provisions that are given in the Act. The Act provides for penalizing those persons who compels transgender persons to indulge in the act of post labor or bonded labor then those persons who denies a transgender person the right of passage to a public place or forces or causes a transgender person to leave household or village or other place of residence, then it also penalizes those persons who harms or injures or endangers the life, safety, health or mental or physical well-being of transgender persons. The Act mentions that they shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 6 months and may extend to 2 years, and also with fine. Now, let us discuss some of the concerns which are raised by the transgender communities and the social activists. The first and foremost is that the title of the Act itself is misleading, that is, the term transgender is restrictive as it does not comprehensively cover the complexities of the transgender community. Further, the Act covers persons with intersex variations as transgender. However, the transgender community perceives transgender as different from intersex. Therefore, the transgender community are demanding that the Act should distinct between the transgender and intersex persons. Then the next concern raised is that the right of transgender for self-identification of their gender. This is because, as per the Supreme Court judgment, the court upheld the right of transgender for self-identification of their gender. However, the Act mandates a certificate of identity as transgender from a district magistrate declaring the holder to be transgender. Therefore, the activists argue that this provision goes against the principle of self-identification. Then another criticism is that the Act does not provide enough affirmative actions for the welfare of transgender and intersex persons. This is because they might require a range of unique healthcare needs. However, the Act does not include these unique healthcare needs for the transgender community. The activists also say that the community and their concerns were not consulted while framing the Act. They also demand to set up a working group for a council for intersex persons was also ignored by the government. The activists also say that the long pending demand to declare forced, unnecessary and non-consensual sex reassignment surgery as illegal was neglected by the government. Therefore, to conclude this news article, we can say that the Act is a step in the right direction for the upliftment of transgender persons who are one of the highly marginalized and vulnerable sections in the society. So, the National Council for Transgender Persons must act proactively to address all legitimate concerns of the transgender people. In addition, the government must accommodate the genuine concerns of the community in the coming days. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Let us start our practice question session. Now, look at this question. This question is based on Overseas Citizen of India. They have given two statements and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 says that an Overseas Citizen of India, that is OCI card holder, is eligible to fundamental rights guaranteed under Article 16. Then second statement says that a person who is or had been a citizen of Pakistan, Bangladesh or Afghanistan, or a person whose either parents or grandparents or great-grandparents is or had been a citizen of either of these countries is not eligible to register as OCI cardholder. So in this context, you should know about the Overseas Citizenship of India scheme, which was introduced by amending the Citizenship Act of 1955 through the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2005. Therefore, as per the scheme, it provides for registration of persons of Indian origin as Overseas Citizen of India. Know that persons of Indian origin, that is PIO, is a person who was an Indian national or any of ancestors was an Indian national and who is presently holding passport of other countries. Now, if you look at the eligibility to register as an OCI card holder, the foreign nationals of the following categories are eligible to register as OCI card holder. That is the person who was a citizen of India or who was eligible to become a citizen of India at the time of the commencement of the Indian Constitution or at any time after the commencement of the Indian Constitution. Then, a person who belonged to a territory that became part of India after India's independence is also eligible to get OCI card. Kindly know that the people of Pakistani and Bangladeshi origin are not eligible to get OCI card. Therefore, the given second statement is incorrect statement. Also know that as per the Indian Constitution, it does not allow dual citizenship or holding Indian citizenship and foreign citizenship simultaneously. The registered overseas citizens of India shall not be entitled to the rights conferred on a citizen of India. That is under Article 16 of the Constitution, which deals with the equality of opportunity in the matters of public employment. The OCI card holders also does not confer political rights for its holders. So the persons registered as OCI card holders have not been given any voting rights, that is to participate in the elections to Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha or Legislative Assembly or to Legislative Council. Even the OCI card holder cannot hold constitutional posts such as President, Vice President or Judges of Supreme Court or Judges of the High Courts. However, the OCI card holders enjoy certain benefits such as they can visit India without visa for lifelong. That means they will have multiple entry lifelong visa for visiting India for any purpose. However, OCI card holders will require a special permission to undertake research work in the country. Then the OCI card holders enjoy parity with non-resident Indians in respect of all facilities that are available to the NRIs in financial and educational fields, but except in the matters related to the acquisition of agricultural or plantation properties. Even the OCI card holders will be treated on par with non-resident Indians in the matters of inter-country adoption of Indian children. So this is all about OCI, that is Overseas Citizen of India. So in this question, the given two statements are incorrect statements. So for this question, option D, that is neither one nor two, is the correct answer. Now look at this question. This question is with reference to Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act of 2019. They have given two statements and you have to choose correct statements. Statement 1 says that it aims to establish a National Council for Transgender Persons chaired by the Prime Minister of India. Then second statement says that a person who forces or causes a transgender person to leave household or village or other place of residence can be punished with a jail term. So in this context, you know that the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act got the assent of President in the month of December 2019, and this act extends to the whole of India. It aims to protect the rights of the transgender community and it also aims to ensure their welfare. As per the provisions of this act, the act defines a transgender person as a person whose gender does not match with the gender assigned to that person at the time of birth. The act also prohibits discrimination against transgender persons on the grounds such as the denial or discrimination or unfair treatment in the matters of educational establishments or in the matters of public employment, or denial or unfair treatment with regard to the right to movement or right to reside or right to purchase. Therefore, these are certain grounds of discrimination. The Act also provides for a certificate of identity. The Act says that a transgender person may make an application to the district magistrate for a certificate of identity indicating the gender as transgender. The Act also requires the government is under obligation to make adequate steps and welfare schemes to secure full and effective participation of transgender persons and their inclusion in the society. Then the another significant provision as per the Act is that the establishment of a National Council for Transgender Persons. This council is headed by the Union Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment. The council will also have representatives from the National Human Rights Commission and National Commission for Women, and also the council have representatives of state governments and union territories, and the council also have representatives of transgender community, and also it has representatives of non-governmental organizations or associations who are working for the welfare of transgender persons. Then the Act also provides penal provisions. That is, the act provides for penalizing those persons who compels transgender persons to indulge in the act of forced labor or bonded labor. Then it also penalizes those persons who denies a transgender person the right of passage to a public place or forces or causes a transgender person to leave household or village or other place of residence. And then it also penalizes those persons who harms or injures or endangers the life, safety, health or mental or physical well-being of transgender persons. Therefore, as per the Act, they shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 6 months and may extend to 2 years and also with fine. Now, if you look at the first statement, it says that the Act aims to establish a National Council for Transgender Persons chaired by the Prime Minister of India. So the given statement one is incorrect because this council is headed by Union Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment. Then look at the second statement. It says that a person who forces or causes a transgender person to leave household or village or other place of residence can be punished with a jail term. So this statement is correct statement. So for this question, option B, that is 2 only, is the correct answer. Now look at this question. This question was asked in UPSC prelims 2017 examination. The question is that in the context of mitigating the impending global warming due to anthropogenic emissions of carbon dioxide, which of the following can be potential sites for carbon sequestration? That is, first site as abandoned and uneconomic coal seams, then depleted oil and gas reservoirs, then subterranean deep saline formations. And you have to choose correct answer using the codes given here. Know that carbon sequestration is the process which involves carbon capture and long-term storage of atmospheric carbon dioxide into carbon sinks. So here carbon sinks is an area that can absorb carbon. There are two types of carbon sinks, that is natural carbon sinks and artificial carbon sinks. Some of the examples of natural carbon sinks includes oceans, forests, soils, etc. Then some of the examples of artificial carbon sinks involves the storage of carbon dioxide in deep underground, then unminable coal beds, then depleted oil and gas reservoirs, then also the suitable subterranean deep saline formations. So all the three sites given in this question are potential sites for carbon sequestration. So for this question, the correct answer is option D, that is 1, 2, 3. Now look at this question. This question is definition based question of carbon sequestration. Option A says a tradable permit representing the right to emit 1 ton of carbon or carbon dioxide equivalent. Then option B says that the process of imposing tax based on the amount of carbon present in a fossil fuel. Then option C says that the process to gain credits by reducing carbon dioxide gas emissions which are made at other locations. Then option D says that it is the process involved in carbon capture and the long-term storage of atmospheric carbon dioxide into an area that absorbs carbon. So for this question, that is definition of carbon sequestration, option D describes the process of carbon sequestration. Now look at this question. This question is based on elimination of TB. Statement 1 says that National Strategic Plan for Tuberculosis Elimination aims to eliminate TB by 2022 in India. Then second statement says that the End TB strategy of WHO aims 95% reduction in number of TB deaths compared with 2015 by 2035 and 90% reduction by 2035 in TB incidence rate compared with 2015. So out of the given two statements, you have to choose correct statements. Know that to reduce the burden of multi-drug resistant TB, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has developed the National Strategic Plan for Tuberculosis for the period of 2017 to 2025. The goal of this NSP is to end TB by 2025. The strategy targets both the drug-resistant TB as well as HIV-resistant TB. Now, if you look at the first statement, it says that the National Strategic Plan aims to eliminate TB by 2022. So, the given first statement is incorrect because it aims to eliminate TB by 2025. Then, at the global level, the World Health Organization passed a resolution in the month of May 2014 that is to end the global TB epidemic. This resolution is known as WHO End TB Strategy. As per this strategy, WHO aims 95% reduction by 2035 in number of TB deaths compared with 2015 and 90% reduction by 2035 in TB incident rate as compared with 2015. The strategy also aims zero TB affected families facing catastrophic cost due to TB by 2035. As per this question, the second statement is correct statement, whereas first statement is incorrect statement. Therefore, option B, 2 only, is the correct answer for this question. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of today's Hindu news analysis. If you like the video, please do like, share, comment and subscribe Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates for civil services examination. Thank you.